So thank you for coming to this session. My name is Tetsuyuki Kobayashi from Japan, working in Kyoto Microcomputer. My session title is ADB, How It Works. So my talk is inside of Android, not for application. So I'm porting Android to these boards. So this is a knowledge from it. First, who am I? I have been involved in embedded system for more than 20 years. The first decade, I did real-time OS such as iTron. The second decade, I did jail virtual machine for embedded systems like mobile phones. I didn't make a Java application. I did internal Java VM such like interpreter, JIT compiler, and garbage collector. Now I'm doing with open source such as GCC, Linux, QEMU, and Android. Especially, I'm studying Android source code since it was released. Now, I have three books, including English one. Please check these pages. And I use Twitter, tweeting every day, but in Japanese. So this is topics in this talk. So ADB means Android's Debug Bridge. At first, I explain what it is and overview. Then dive into the source code and key points. And I show you command detail from inside and also tips I found. That last advanced topics. What is ADB? ADB means Android Debug Bridge. If you are Android builder, you may have used Android ADB logcat and also ADB shell. So it's a familiar command. Even if you only use DDMS in Eclipse, but ADB is working under the hood. Using ADB, you can connect emulator or actual target devices. Sometimes the mentions ADB queue server. What does it mean? There is ADB client commands such as ADB shell and ADB logcat. They connect to Android emulator running in the same host or the Android target devices. How do they connect? So how do they connect? The three elements, there are three elements of ADB: ADB clients, ADB server, and ADB daemons. ADB clients executable with subcommands such as ADB shell, ADB logcat, and this is familiar with. This directory operates commands. ADB server, it's running on the host on the background. They act as a proxy server between ADB clients and ADB daemons. ADB daemon and ADBD are running on target devices. Started on init, if die, restarting by init again. So this is an overview. ADB client commands and connect to ADBD on the target, but not directory. They do through ADB server. Yes. So ADB server is here, and ADB server act as proxy. It establish communication path to ADBD in real target device or in emulator. To emulator, I use TCP socket, TCP local socket to real target device, mainly use USB, but TCP is available too. Every daemon is running in target, get request, and create new threads or subprocess to execute services like this. There is two big worlds of ADB, transport and services. So providing transport and communication paths between host and target devices and USB or TCP, but clients don't have to aware it. Provide services executing some sensing on the target devices through the transport. ADB shell for executing commands, or ADB push or ADB pull for file transfer. So ADB server is running background on the host. When does it start? Usually, it starts automatically on demand, so you don't have to start it. Sometimes, if you do explicitly, ADB start server. Sometimes ADB server get wrong or change some setting, you need to restart ADB server. To do it, ADB queue server and ADB start server. You can omit ADB start server because it does automatically. Actually, ADB clients and ADB server shares same executable. ADB start server equals ADB fork server and running background like this. So the important commands are the port forwarding. So ADB forward, in this case, TCP 1234 and TCP 1234. So these commands makes this socket. These sockets the local socket, the local server socket in the host side, and client socket in a target side, and establish this pipeline over a USB or TCP transport. So, for example, using GDB debugger, and that. Other target devices are running GDB server and connect to the local host port 1234 and communication this. And ADB forwards connect this socket and this. So your host side GDB client connects to the this port. Then this GDB client and GDB server can communicate and work with it. So both GDB server, GDB client and GDB server do not aware of transport. This is even if this is USB or TCP, these two don't aware it. So it is very easy to use. So this example is GDB. So now, yesterday, I found Chrome for Android has a very good remote debugger. It is also using ADB forward. It is running on HTTP, a web service running on the target, and the host sites just run web browser and the connect socket made by ADB4 command. So the next, I will show you ADB internal. In source codes, ADB source code is including in Android source tree, and the directory is here, system core ADB. And the source codes is the line size is this, and only C and header files. And from this directory, both ADB and ADB daemon are built. So we have confuse. So these files are commonly used, both ADB and ADB daemon. And in the source codes, there is a conditional preprocessor defined. If ADB host, this is put in the code for ADB, and else, this is code for ADB daemon. And these files is used only for ADB daemon, and these files is only for ADB at the host side. So you can see this, for example, get my pass Linux for Linux and for Darwin, for Windows and FreeBSD. These OSs is supported in ADB host. And also, the directory has documents, these three files. And this is a little bit old, so you have to check source code. But very good to start. So then, how to get ADB logs? For ADB client and ADB server, set environment and ADB trace. So if you want to get all types of logs, set ADB trace to all. When you change this variable, you need to restart ADB server like this. Once kill and set environment and restart the server. For target size and ADB daemon, set system property. Persist ADB face masks. In hexadecimals. So if you want to all logs set like this, this needs a root permission. So logs are categorized, so you get only particular logs if you specify log tag. See this URL to for the detail. And I found some trivial bugs about logging. So my patches are available in this site. This slide is I will publish my SlideShare account, so you can get slide and these URLs later. So then, get a log information. I write a simple sequence chart. This is example at ADB shell LS. So it sends a request to ADB server, host version to query version, and host transport any to specify destination, and then shell colon address. ADB server redirect to ADB day after the commands. In documents, it is called smart socket. So between ADB server and ADB daemon, it is connected by USB. These packets, this communication, this packet is through the USB. And so shell colon ls, so ADB daemon gets this request, so ADB daemon create new sub-process and executes ls on that. The ls output is here, and this to the ADB server, and then this is goes through ADB clients, and after, finally the result is on output it on the standard output. Next, I wrote simple Ruby script, which is equivalent to ADB shell ls in the client side. So this side, there is some definition of functions. And look at this function send to ADB daemon. So when you are sending the request to the ADB server, at first, the sending the length of commands in 4 digits in hexadecimal, and then request string itself. And this side, the main command sequence, and at first, and opening socket localhost port 5037, and then command send command to host version to version check. At once closed and opens again the same socket and send a command host transport any, and then shell colon ls. After that, reading the socket until EOF and copy them to the standard out. And in this script, it is equivalent to ADB shell ls. So you can change this shell.ls as you like. For example, replace this to frame buffer column, so you can get raw data of screen capture. So if you tweet this script, you can experiment easily. So next, about secure mode. Android smartphone product have ADB relay. When you set enabled USB debugging at setting application, ADB relay starts inside. At product, ADB daemon is running in non-privileged mode. It is on secure mode, secure equal one. If secure equals one, ADB daemon changes itself as shell user by set UID and set GID system calls. If secure equals zero, it keeps running as root. In secure mode, all services involved in all services invoked by ADB daemon runs as shell user. Sometimes it causes permission denied. How secure mode decided? If it is running on emulator, it is always secure zero, secure zero. Otherwise, reading system property ro.secure, if this is one or not set, secure becomes one. Even if RO.secure is 1. If RO.debuggable equals 1, you can restart ADB unsecure mode by invoking ADB root. All Android phone products are shipped in RO secure is 1, RO debuggable is 0, so that it cannot run ADBD as root. For detail, see function ADB main in ADBbot.c and also this URL. Next, switching transport mode. ADB daemon transport is either USB or TCP. It is exclusive. USB is default if USB driver is available in the device. If you want to switch from USB mode to TCP mode, do like this. So examine IP address, target IP address using netcfg commands. Then after that, type ADB TCP IP 5555. This is port number, where port number is odd number from 5555 to 5585. Because only ADB server checks only these ports. After that, check by ADB devices. If disconnected like this, it is a good sign. If still USB connection is available, it seems failed to switching TCP. Explain this later. So after changing to TCP modes, connected by TCP, you have to restart ADB server like this. Once kill ADB server and set environment environments ADB host to target IP address. This is same as this. And ADB and restart ADB daemon. Then you can see this. So whenever it connects through TCP, and if it is not emulator, the name start with emulator. I think this is some historical reason. So let me explain what happened inside when ADB TCP IP. For detail, please see function restart TCP service in service.c. Here, it sets a system property services.adb.tcp.port by function property set like this. This checks permission. Oops. So before Android 4.0, this calls permission denied in secure mode and ignored silently. So the TCP, switching TCP mode is failed. So setting property set, after that, ADB daemon terminates itself by using system code exit. Then init daemon restarts ADB daemon. ADB daemon checks system property service ADB TCP ports at the beginning. So change the modes. If this property is not set because of permission denied, ADB daemon runs in USB mode again. So for the previous page, using ADB TCP IP, even if it says restarting IP, restarting in TCP mode ports, this is displayed, it may permission denied in Android 2.3 or before Android devices. So I wonder, in secure mode, why Android 1.36 is to switch and Android 2.3 fail. I compare the source code and find the difference. There's only one line added in property services didn't see in Android 4.12. I added this line. So this is a permission setting to this system property. So I added this line in Android 2.3 and rebuild system. Then I succeed to switch to TCP mode in secure mode. So for detail, I'm right in this URL. And then I show you inside of command detail and some tips. This is inside of ADB logcat. There is log dots some command in ADB server, but ADB logcat doesn't use it. Now actually, ADB logcat executes slash system slash bin slash logcat remotely using shell subcommand. So target filtering is done in target side. If you use DDMS, it has a similar function to C logs. In this case, DDMS requests ADB data server by a log sum command to get raw data of log. A target filtering is done in host side. ADB logcat is almost same as this. This command. So look at this environment variable, Android log types, this is used. So if you set this variable, you don't have to specify target filtering option every time at ADB logcat. Next, inside of ADB install and ADB uninstall. ADB install transfer APK file and then execute system bin PM command at the device. And ADB uninstall, this is just execute system bin PM remotely. So that's it. So it means if you don't use ADB commands, and you can directly use this the PM commands. You can install the application, install and uninstall applications. And next, ADB reboot and ADB reboot bootloader. ADB in ADB daemon. This is the fork and exec system bin VDC command to unmount storage and wait for the process and then reboot by system calls. So this is helpful to know what is a safe way to reboot. And ADB EMU. You can send a single command to emulator command console easy. So this is sending only, not receive. For emulator console, please refer this URL. So using emulator console, this is a convenient way to scale the Windows. The simple example, and ADB EMU window scale 0.5. It shrinks the emulator. ADB window scale 1.0, it's returned to the original size. It is very useful. And also ADB backup and restore. This is new in Android 4.0. You can backup and restore installed application with the saved status. I think this is useful. And also, there are some joke command too. You may know this, ADB help. This is the same as ADB shell except a color. Try please write. And also, I found it when reading the source code, and ADB LOL cat is the same as ADB logcat. I'm not an English native, so what does it mean, logcat? And next, about adding USB vendor ID. When connecting the Android device to USB ports, ADB server checks USB class and AU subclass and vendor ID. The vendor ID must match with ID list in ADB. Many USB vendor IDs are already hard-coded in ADB, but sometimes it is not enough. If the device's USB vendor ID is not in the list, you need to add. To do this, make text file written in one ID in one line, as the file name is adbusb.ini, and put it to home directory under home directory dot android directory if it is in Linux. And in Windows, the same, the different directory. For detail, see USB underbar bender.c. And this is one of tips. I'm not sure it is useful or not, but all server sockets in Android emulator accepts only from localhost. So this ADB server can communicate with the same hosts and ADB server using local ports, but if you want to communicate from other host, it cannot. Ouch. So usually this and this is in the same machine, but for my case, I'm using this machine is build and compile only, and my Windows system is another machine. So then the client and some web browser is running the other machine, and in that case I want to connect this machine to this. It is not it always fails, and I check the source code. So Android emulator is based on QEMU, but original QEMU does not have this restriction. So I compared the source code and found what part is affected. Next page, I show you the patch. So add a new function socket in Android any server in socket points.c, like this, and call it instead of these functions. That's it. And server socket created by ADB forward also have a similar restriction. So this socket and this socket, this server socket is only for localhost only, so you can't use the other host to connect. This connection is restricted. So this is sometimes this is inconvenient. So I modify and the patch is here. call this function instead of this. So this is just an experiment. So I don't think about some security issue. This is only for my convenience. And next, I will show you two of advanced topics. The first one is Android 4.0 newly has system bin ADB. I tweak it. The second one is I consider about how to use ADB on other than Android. So ADB in Android devices. Usually, ADB is running on the host side, such as Linux, Mac OS, and Windows. The Android 4.0, there is this command, system bin ADB in Android file system. So ADB can run Android itself. What for is this? So at first, I have no idea to use this. But just try type an ADB device. But no Android device found, even itself. In this moment, ADB daemon is in USB mode because it is default. There is no Android devices to connect. Next, I tried the same thing after switching TCP mode. Then ADB devices found one Android device, it is itself. Android's ADB supposed to connect from outside, but TCP socket can connect from inside. It is local loopback. So system bin ADB seems to work, but I don't know the good use case for it. So in chat, it's like this. So ADB daemon, this is supposed to connect from the outside, but in this case, ADB server is running in the same Android devices and it can connect using a loopback. So I wrote these things to my blogs, and someone said, and someone tweeted, so is it possible to communicate by ADB between two Android devices? Oh, that's it. So I tried like this. So I'm using this board to porting reads. And I pick up my Nexus 1 and connect user cable. This is a micro USB, and this is a USB host. And then try the same thing. I'll just type ADB devices. So then it finds Nexus 1 like this. This is a Nexus 1. So it means from Android boards to recognize the Nexus 1 in a USB cable. So I tried the ADB shell, ADB logcat, and ADB put and ADB push and something. So all success. So it means I can debug and get logs Nexus 1 through Android device. And also, I tried the install application from the board to Nexus 1 using Android IDB install, some APK. It also successed. So the next port on ADB day to other than Android. So after this investigation, I found ADB is very nice tool, and I want to use ADB in other than Android. The host side of ADB and ADB server, it can use as is. But all I have to do is porting ADB daemon to other system. I tried quick hack to run ADB day on ARM Ubuntu 11.10. So like this. So using Android patched kernel, and the user land is Android ARM Ubuntu 11.10, and put ADB daemon executables copy, just copy it and try. So this file slash sbin ADB daemon is a statically linked executable. Android and ARM Ubuntu are using the same ABI, so the file will run as is. This is just for experiment. So the USB driver for ADB and the kernel is needed, so I used ADB Android patched kernel. So somehow I succeeded to run ADB daemon in Ubuntu. So all I have to do, I did is change these device files to set change the mode and make a symbolic link slash bin slash shell to system bin shell. Because ADB daemon is not changed, so ADB daemon used to access this path to invoke shell. So ADB daemon runs in secure mode because the Android system property is not working. So when reading reads system property, it is not read, so the old user default value. And as a default, ADB daemon run in secure mode. So this is running in shell user. So that's it cannot access this device file. So I modified the change modes to ADB daemon can access this. So finally, it should handle by uevent daemon. So uevent rules should modify. So it worked on the ADB shell and ADB puts at the puts. It is interesting. And the detail, please see these pages. So after the binary experiments, let's consider the current ADB daemon depends on what of Androids for better porting. So some service requires other Android commands, such like an ADB install and uninstall and the ADB bug reports, and it invokes other Android commands. And also the frame buffer service invokes system bin screen cap commands. So in this case, so you consider about porting also this command, all right. Also, ADB daemon use Android system properties. So other binary experiments, all property gets returns default values. So that's why ADB daemon runs in secure modes. So we have to modify these things or port system properties to other system. And switching ADB daemon modes assume that it need to restart ADB day process. So and init also modified to restart ADB daemon. So that's it. So this is all my presentation. Do you have any questions?
Are your slides online anywhere?
I will put after that immediately. But sorry about there is many links on the form to blogs, but blogs is written in Japanese, sorry. But but I think that blog is very technical, so a machine translation will work, I think.
Where do you put them in your blog?
What?
The presentation, where do you put them?
And. Maybe this one. Also, I will provide this presentation to the Linux Foundation. So I think Linux Foundation web page makes some links. I think so.
You said that GB doesn't was not modified at all to work over ADB, or was it modified somehow to work over
ADB? GDB, I don't modify GDB. Just specify. That's the socket.
Okay, so the GDB is working over ADB, is that correct?
Yeah.
And it wasn't modified, it just starts using it? It just, you know how the GDB works over ADB?
Yes. So so the good example is NDK GDB. What's yes. So in this case, remote socket and local socket is using TCP socket. This is work at the real target, but in emulator, this won't work. So in NDK GDB, NDK GDB is actually shell script, so you can read it. And the NDK GDB using the remote side, it's using not TCP socket, but Unix domain socket. So I guess some emulators network is very complex, so some avoid something. But in this case, it works at through the real target, it works.
I have a question about one of your slides. When you showed it and reverting from USB to TCP mode, then it was an emulator instance or on a real device? Because at the beginning, can you please switch to the slide when you showed it?
What? US? This?
The first one, I mean, it doesn't look like a QEMU network. And then when you list it, it's an emulator device. So what's really going on there?
In this case, I'm not using an emulator, the real device. I think. So in emulator does not use the USB. Emulator uses TCP only. So it may network is not apt. So you should run so something like about net CFG up or net CFG DHCP or something.
Okay.
your devices together?
Mm-hmm.
Was one of them in host mode and the other in peripheral mode?
Or did you use both of them in peripheral mode and connect it through a hub, or how did you connect the two?
So if in this case,
yes,
using USB cable. USB cable is has a direction. So one end is host and one end is target. So this act as host and this act as target.
I see. Okay, thanks.
Hi, you had a slide deck that said all server sockets on the client or on the device can only use the local loop. Is that correct? Without your hack?
And this chat?
Yes. Actually, if you go to the next slide,
yeah,
that makes more sense for you anyway.
Yes.
When you look at that, you're saying this particular hack solves that problem. Now we can open server-side sockets on any of the devices.
So, when I saw the source codes, I said, so all the server socket is local, that's function, socket, local group server. So there is no function to any server. So I added a new function.
Got it. And that's socket.c. Okay. Great. Thank you.
This one?
No, page one.
Page one? Page. What? This one?
Yeah.
So any other question? So thank you very much.